Paltrocast.
Day's going good. Day's going really good. It's nice to be able to get a talk about this film and to have this film be released.
Great cast in Prey. How did you wind up on this particular project? Because you're past the point of Cattle Call auditions. I'm assuming it was a producer went, hey, Emile's the right person for this.
Well, so I had actually worked with the writer-director, Mukunda, on The Immaculate Room. So, you know, this was him emailing me the script and being like, hey, check this out. What do you think? And reading it and just thinking it was really well written and different and an interesting role to play. And then he said Ryan was attached. And I was like really happy about that because Ryan and I have known each other for years, but we've never worked together and we always wanted to. And he's such a good guy and he's such a sweet, open-hearted guy. He was perfect for the role. And, you know, we had a really good time making the film, even though we were freezing because we were shooting in Valencia in the winter and it was supposed to be like South Africa, Kalahari Desert in the summer. But so we were really cold and psychologically that can take a toll. And as far as, you know, Ryan had really the hardest job on set because he's dealing with a character that not only has he lost someone that he loves, but also his faith. And, you know, he's a Christian missionary. Everything in his whole life is about dedication to God. So to have that kind of taken away from him, you know, the part took a toll for sure. Sometimes I would just be like the cheerleader on set trying to like improve everybody's mood and stuff. Cause there's this like, when there's such a tragic role, it's very hard to just shake that off, you know?
How did you warm up? Sorry to rudely interrupt here. A lot of heat lamps, a lot of blankets, all the above?
Heat lamps and blankets? I don't know. I think we had like a jacket. I think the jacket was the main savior there.
Yeah, a lot of your roles involve you being outdoors and are suffering. But it's great to hear that it was lighthearted in this one, that it was a nice cast and crew. And it's kind of the exact opposite of a movie of yours I randomly stumbled upon, An Evening with Beverly Luft Lynn.
Oh, yeah.
Now, I wanted to ask you about the one for a minute because I've never seen much said about that movie. Did you know that it was that weird while you were filming it, or was it all made weird in the editing room?
Oh, yeah, we knew it was totally weird because Jim Hosking, you know, he had made a bunch of shorts and he made a movie called The Greasy Strangler, which was like a crazy movie. So as soon as I watched that, I was like, oh, wow, this is going to be super out there. You know, Jim, you know, really encouraged me to kind of get into physical comedy of it all and really kind of add in a certain slapstick kind of out there element. Of like the nightmare oppressive husband, almost like a, you know, distilled version of that. And I certainly loved working with Aubrey Plaza and Jermaine Clement. They were both so, so good. Just great actors and just everybody involved in that film was fun. We shot that in Eureka, California, like Northern California.
England. I thought that was shot in England.
Oh, no. It's in Eureka. It's a strange flick.
So that's in Eureka. Then this one is in Valencia, Prey, we're talking about right here. So I'm learning that California has a lot of parts of it that could be Europe or Africa or other continents in general.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's a little bit disillusioning when people learn of all the movies they love and where those movies were actually shot. You have to be a little careful as an audience member when you do too much digging into the films you love, because you might find out that like it wasn't anywhere near where you thought it was. And it's, you're just like, oh my gosh, I'm questioning everything, you know? And it's just the reality of the way that, you know, these things are made.
Yeah, Rocky Balboa fighting Drago in British Columbia doesn't quite have the ring to it like Russia does. But
yeah,
back to you, you know, that was a rare comedic role for you, but you also are talented as a musician. What's coming up on the musical end, if anything?
Right now, you know, I haven't been songwriting for a little while now. Maybe down the line, you know, we'll make some more songs, me and the Frenchman. But yeah, I haven't really been writing any songs lately. I've been working on some screenplays, you know, just working on a couple different drafts of some things that I found interesting. So that's sort of been my sort of writing outlet per se. But yeah, no, I haven't. It's weird. Songwriting is a thing where I just never wanted to force it. But then, you know, it's also been kind of a while since I've had any kind of desire to write down a song. And I, you know, at one point I tried to make myself like 9 months ago, I was like, all right, I'm going to write a song. It's been too long. And like, that was the wrong reason to write a song. And it really showed. And it's just, it has to be, I think the best way to do it is you have to really just be inspired to express yourself or something.
Well, the rate that you've been going the past few years, it looks like it's 3 to 5 movies a year. But if you're also writing screenplays, I think your creative Jones is out there. Maybe you don't need another thing like songwriting.
Yeah, you could be right too.
Yeah, you don't want to be one of those people that has to do an album a year just so that their All Music Guide listing looks like they did an album a year.
Yeah. No. And honestly, like making an album a year, it's a lot more work than making like a couple movies a year. Like albums take a long, especially the way that the Frenchman and I made the records and he produced them is, you know, there's so many layers to the sound and it takes so long to craft each song.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, it's a lot of work, especially with the electronic way that we made it. You know, mm-hmm. if we were just playing, if I was just banging on the banjo and singing into a mic, maybe we could make an album a year, right? But not in the kind of hyper electronic space that we've been operating in.
Not when you're making good art. Well, the last question I have before I let you go, Prey is a new movie to us. It's an old movie to you. Do you know where we're going to see you next, or where we're allowed to know that we're going to see you next?
I have a couple of films in the can that are going to be released. There's a film called Degenerate, which is kind of a poker movie that I'm really proud of. And a film called Bao, Artist at War, which is like a kind of a Holocaust movie and that I'm really proud of. And let me try to think what else. There's those two.
A lot of one name movies for you between those and Dig and Walden, in a good way.
Yeah.
And the last question before I let you go, you know, related to the musical end, what's the last concert that you went to?
Oh, gosh, it was. I went to Steven Tyler's charity benefit and he sang a song. So technically Aerosmith.
Technically Aerosmith. He is at least 40% of Aerosmith right there. That makes sense. So thank you for your many years of great art, whether it's on the screen, behind the screen, on the record and all that. And looking forward to the next project. But in the meantime, congrats on Prey.
Thank you very much. Paltrocast.